All right, the part of the chapter that I want to focus on is there in the very beginning. We'll begin reading in verse number 1, chapter 2 of Timothy, verse number 1. It says, "Thou therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus, and the things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men who shall be able to teach others also." And the title of my sermon this morning is Teach Others Also. And this is an extremely important subject. Right there in verse number 2, we have Paul speaking unto Timothy, his protege in the faith, his son in the faith, and he makes the statement, "And the things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men who shall be able to teach others also." So we see four generations there, or four different sets of Christians. We see Paul, who is there in turn teaching Timothy. Timothy, what he learned from Paul, he takes and he says, commit it to faithful men. But not only just the faithful men that you think are going to be able to teach the next generation. We're going to be able to teach the next new Christian. And that's what I'm going to preach about. I'm going to preach about teaching others. The importance of taking other people under our wing. Whatever role or responsibilities that we have. Because we have different responsibilities. Obviously, just in general as a Christian in the Bible, you know, we should be teaching others those things. But there's also different responsibilities of the wife, of the mother, of the husband, of the father. Different roles in the ministry. Of a pastor, of a deacon, of an evangelist. And if somebody is in this role, they should be being proactive. You should be proactive, and you should be looking for people to teach. You shouldn't be waiting for people to come to you. And there's perfect examples of this over and over in the Bible, but I believe that Paul is the best example. Look in verse number 1 there, what he says. "Thou therefore, my son." Now look at chapter number 1. Look at chapter number 1 again. "Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, according to the promise of life which is in Christ Jesus, to Timothy, my dearly beloved son." Now go over to 1 Timothy chapter number 1, the first epistle that was written to Timothy. 1 Timothy chapter number 1. And that's my first example of men in the ministry training other men that are going to be in the ministry and the importance of that. Look at 1 Timothy chapter number 1 again. "Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the commandment of God our Savior and Lord Jesus Christ, which is our hope." Watch again verse number 2. "Unto Timothy, my own son in the faith." A lot of people look at it and say, well, Paul got Timothy saved. No, he didn't. Turn to Acts chapter number 16. Acts chapter number 16. He's not referring to Timothy as his son because that's the fruit that he brought forth and got him saved. You can prove that actually another way by looking at 2 Timothy, because he talks about, you know, "And that from a child thou hast known the holy scriptures." He talks about the faith that dwelled in his grandmother Eunice and then also in his mother. You know, Timothy was born in a Christian family. Timothy was born and brought up and taught the scriptures by his mother. And when Paul met him, he was already saved. He was already a Christian. But he's his son in the sense that he took him under his wing. Watch the way that it's worded as well here in Acts chapter number, yeah, I believe it's 16. Acts chapter number 16, verse number 1. "Then came he to Derbe and Lystra, and behold, a certain disciple was there named Timotheus." Look, he's already a disciple. The Bible's very clear. "The son of a certain woman which was a Jewess and believed, but his father was a Greek, which was well reported of by the brethren that were at Lystra and Iconium." So he's already well reported. The next verse is really what I wanted to focus on. Watch what it says. "Him," referring to Timothy, "would Paul have to go forth with him." So Paul actually approaches Timothy. It's Paul's will, or it's Paul's idea that, hey, Timothy, you're going to come with me, and everything that I know, I'm going to teach you. And that's the attitude that we should have in whatever area, whatever roles or responsibilities that we have. Everything that we know, it shouldn't be like an occult or anything like that. It shouldn't be like a secret information. We should be looking for other Christians, for other believers, for other, you know, people that have the desire to be a deacon in my position, or when I'm a pastor, other people that want to be a pastor. And I should be seeking out people and trying to teach them what I know. And trying to entrust it unto people that I believe are going to be teaching the next generation. Now look at Matthew chapter number 28. While we're on the subject of men in the ministry, go to Matthew chapter number 28. Just the importance of teaching what you've been taught. Teaching others also. And you can see that pattern there where he says, Paul taught Timothy. Paul, I taught you, Timothy. Timothy, I want you to teach, you know, the next generation. And then I want that generation or that those new Christians, you know, to teach the next generation. It doesn't even necessarily have to be reflective from age. You know, it could be an older man that gets saved that comes into the church. And he starts coming here, Faith Forward Baptist Church North. You could just approach that. A perfect example of that within this church is Daniel, who comes to all the afternoon and all the evening services. I can't remember exactly how old he is, but he's like 13, 14. And he's recently getting people saved. Now, that would have been a perfect example, and maybe this took place, of someone when he started coming and they see that he's devout, they see that he wants to learn the Bible, where they go to him and they say, hey, every soul anytime, you can come with me. And while you're walking between houses, you can start trying to teach him the things that you know. You can start trying to teach him how to give the gospel, the ways to speak to people, all the different tips and methods that you've learned over time. That's a perfect example of you can bring forth that fruit, or you can have a son in the faith. Look at Matthew chapter number 28. The famous passage of the Great Commission there in verse number 19. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. So there's many things while Jesus Christ, God in the flesh, while he walked on the earth and he had his disciples following him, that he taught to his disciples. When it was time for Jesus to leave, he told his disciples, everything that I've taught you, I want you to go out and I want you to teach others also. I want you to go out and everything I've commanded you, I want you to teach to other people. Teach it to all nations. Teach it to whoever you can. It's an information, obviously, once we get people saved. You know, we just don't want people to be a babe in Christ the rest of their life. We don't just want people to have salvation and that's all that they have. They have no spiritual growth. They have no rewards in heaven. They have no happiness, or they're not blessed while they're on this earth. We should desire, when we see a new Christian that doesn't know the Bible, we should desire for them to know the Bible. And then if you have that desire, the very next step is to approach them, befriend them, come up to them, and start teaching them and proselyting them. You can take that person under your wing. Go to Deuteronomy chapter number 6, verse number 1. Deuteronomy chapter number 6, verse number 1. And that's what I love the most about these soul-winning marathons. The best part about the soul-winning marathons isn't the people that get saved that day. I mean, I'm not downplaying all the people that get saved that day. That's awesome. But the best part of the soul winning marathons is that, almost everyone at the marathon is, it seems like over half, every time you go to these marathons, over half of the people, it's their first time out soul winning. And there was a guy there, I believe his name was Austin, who got the first person saved that he'd ever gotten saved. And he was out for 4.5 hours. Well, it would have been longer than that because he skipped lunch. He was out for like 5-6 hours. He had actually never been soul winning before, but he had practiced a lot. And he went out like the first 4 hours with, I think, it was a pretty seasoned soul winner. You know, I can't remember exactly who it was, but he was with them for like 4 hours just watching them. And they got quite a few people saved that morning, much more than everybody else. But they got like 4 or 5 people saved. So he had all that time that he had already prepared himself. And then he probably had a good teacher that he was able to see it in real action, who was able to say, hey, come with me, right? And teach them. And then at the end of the day, that person was able to get their first person saved. And the very first person saved. Now, I desire to have people, you know, that I can bring underneath my wing, that I can teach my soul-winning methods to, that I can teach, you know, the knowledge that I know from the Bible to that person. I desire to have those people. And everyone should have that. Whatever role or responsibilities you're in, you should desire to teach whatever you know to other people. Look at Deuteronomy chapter number 6, verse number 1. It says, now these are the commandments, the statutes and the judgments which the Lord your God commanded to teach you, that ye might do them in the land whither ye go to possess it, that thou mightest fear the Lord thy God, to keep all his commandments and his to keep all his statutes and his commandments which I command thee, thou and thy son's son, all the days of thy life, and that thy days may be prolonged. So notice there what God says to Moses. He says, I taught you things and commandments that I want you to keep. And he said, and then I also want your sons to keep these commandments, and you to teach your sons these commandments. And then I also want your sons to teach your sons' sons. That's what I want. I want you to teach your children what I've taught you, just like how Jesus taught his disciples. Then I want your children to teach their children. So that's why it's so important for us with our kids. This is my next point. That's why it's so important for us to take it very seriously while our children are growing up, the knowledge that we dispense to them. It is so important that we train up our children in the way that they should go. Because here's the thing. You may take your children to church, but that's not enough. People will talk about, I at least have the right disciplinary method. I at least spank my children. That's not enough. Taking your children to church is good. Spanking your children is good. Obviously when your children, do wrong, they need to be disciplined. But they also need to be taught what is right. They'll never be able to do what's right. If you just spanked your children every time and never gave them any sort of explanation and never actually said, this is what I want you to do and this is what I don't want you to do. I mean, at some point they would start catching on to those things. Like, hey, every time I do that, I'm going to get a spanking. But there are areas of life that they would never grow in. There are areas of life where they would never learn, this is what I should be doing and this is what I shouldn't be doing. Spanking your children is great. Disciplining your children is great, but you also have to have in tandem teaching your children. You also have to sit your children down, and teach your children the Bible. And talk to your children about the Bible. Talk to your children about Jesus. Keep reading there. And actually, go to chapter 11, look at verse number 19. I found it though. You're in chapter 11. I'll read to you here from Deuteronomy chapter 6. I'm going to keep reading in the passage there. It's a little bit lower. In verse number 3, it says, "Hear therefore, O Israel, and observe to do it, that it may be well with thee, and that ye may increase mightily as the Lord God of thy fathers hath promised thee, in the land that floweth with milk and honey. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord, and thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thine heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy might. And these words which I command thee this day shall be in thine heart." Watch what he says. "And thou shalt teach them diligently unto thy children, and shalt talk of them when thou sittest in thine house, and when thou walkest by the way, and when thou liest down, and when thou risest up. And thou shalt bind them for a sign upon thine hand, and they shall be as frontlets between thine eyes." You're in Deuteronomy chapter number 11. We'll begin reading in verse number 19. We'll read in 18. "Therefore shall ye lay up these my words in your heart and in your soul, and bind them for a sign upon your hand, that they may be as frontlets between your eyes. And ye shall teach them your children, speaking of them when thou sittest in thine house, and when thou walkest by the way, when thou liest down, and when thou risest up. And thou shalt write them upon the doorposts of thine house and upon thy gates, that your days may be multiplied, and the days of your children in the land which the Lord sware unto your fathers to give them, as the days of heaven upon the earth." So notice how many times he mentions the importance of making sure that you teach your children these commandments. He says in the very beginning of Deuteronomy chapter number 6, verse 1. Then he mentions it basically in all parts of the day. When you lie down, when you rise up, when you walk by the way, make sure you're teaching your children. Then just 5 chapters later, again, he brings it up another time. He talks about the importance of the commandments, and then right after that, he mentions the importance of teaching those commandments to your children. Obviously, we love our children, and we want our children, like he's talking about here, with the commandments comes a blessing, and we want our children to be blessed. So it would be silly, it would be hateful for us not to teach our children the commandments. It would be hateful for us not to raise our children up in the way that we should go. And I love my kids, so I want my children to read and to love the Bible. I desire for my children to have the same love for God that I have. I desire for my children to love the Bible the same way that I have. I don't want my children, to just grow up and just feel like Christianity is just like a tradition, like most Catholics, that Christianity or the Bible is just like just a part of our life. It's just a routine of something that we do, but that it just has no importance. Now, I have you turn to Deuteronomy chapter number 31, verse number 19. The reason why a lot of people don't do this is because it takes a lot of time. Obviously, the mother is at home with the children all day, so it's easier for her to teach the children. It's primarily her job to teach the children. But also, you know, throughout the day, obviously, she has responsibilities. She has things she has to do, too. So she still has to go out of her way to make sure that she's making that a priority and teaching her kids. But even when the father comes home, there should be a time maybe set out of the week where you have a Bible time for your family, where you have a time like, hey, I know every Tuesday and Thursday when I come home, I'm going to sit down with my family and I'm going to read the Bible to them. I'm going to talk to them about the Bible. You know, I'm going to make sure that we sing hymns together, whatever you may do. You know, and obviously being a good example is great too. When they see, you know, when my daughter sees me opening up my Bible every day and reading it, and then I have her every day, I have a commandment for her every day to make sure you're reading your Bible, she's going to be more likely to open up her Bible. It's going to be easier for her at least. She's going to be more willing. It's not going to feel like as much of a chore if she sees me doing it as well. Setting the good example makes it easier when you start to teach. If you're already doing these things and then they can see you doing them, obviously nobody, even a child, wants to follow a hypocrite. Not even a child wouldn't want to watch their father, you know, tell them over and over again, hey, read your Bible, when you never read your Bible. So we need to be setting a good example too. So when we do go to our children and say, hey, you need to pray, you need to read your Bible, you need to keep these commandments, that we're already setting that example. You know, and like I said, a lot of people don't do it, even Christians don't do it, because it takes a lot of time. You know, it takes time out of the day. You have to set time apart. You have to say, hey, this time, you know, we're going to sit down and we're going to read our Bible. After you get home from work, a lot of times you don't feel like it. But it's that important where you need to set time apart and you need to say, hey, I'm going to make sure the things that I know, I'm going to teach my children so that they can teach others also, so that they can teach their children. And you know, it's really important to make sure that we're diligent with our children today, because we don't only want to just teach our children, we want them to know and love the truths that we teach them so much to where they're going to teach the next generation. Where we need to impress upon them the importance of it to where they're like, you know what, I need to make sure that I teach my kids this. There's a lot of generations that grow up, you know, around the Bible in some sense. But they didn't see, like I was saying earlier, they didn't see the example, number one, of their parents doing what they're teaching them to do. They don't see the zeal in their parents. They don't see, you know, the importance being impressed upon them. And then they just see it as a routine. And they don't end up passing it down to the next generation. I want my grandkids to serve God. I want my great-grandkids to serve God. So I'm going to make sure that the kid, that my daughter, my sons, all of my children that I have today, that when I teach them, that I'm going to be as diligent as I can to try to get them to teach their children as well. You know what it does too? Another thing that I just thought of, when you have to teach something, you have to understand it to a new level. You know, when you start reading the Bible in the beginning, some things are difficult. Obviously, you know, you may have a very low level understanding of something. But then if I were to say, hey, teach that to someone else, you're really going to struggle. You have to understand something in a great way, in a good way. You know, you have to understand something very well to be able to teach it, especially to a child. When someone, obviously, you know, when you're giving the gospel in the beginning, this is a good example of that. It's the hardest to give it to children because they're the easiest to get saved, though, number one. But when you're giving the gospel to children, a lot of times you have to explain it in a very simple way. And every child is different, so they're going to be asking questions, so you have to kind of go at it from different angles. Therefore, you have to have a wide spectrum of an understanding of the gospel. The same thing is when you're teaching the Bible, just different doctrines to your children. So you have to have a very good understanding of the Bible in order to be able to teach it. Now, look at Deuteronomy chapter number 31, verse number 19, something else we should be teaching to our children. Deuteronomy 19. Now therefore, write ye this song for you, and teach it the children of Israel. Put it in their mouths, that this song may be a witness for me against the children of Israel. So we see another example here of Moses being taught something. When he says the children of Israel there, he's just speaking of Israel in general. But we see there something coming from God, given to Moses, and then Moses teaching that to someone else as well. So all these things, you know, apply not only to our children, they apply to every area of life. So Another thing that we need to be teaching to others also, our children obviously included, but just everyone in general, we need to be teaching to others to sing the hymns, the songs of the faith. Turn to Ephesians chapter number 5, verse number 19. Ephesians chapter number 5, verse number 19. Ephesians chapter number 5, verse number 19. And a big, big struggle for a lot of new believers, a lot of, you know, babes in Christ, when they come in and they're wanting to get their life right, but, you know, the Spirit's, you know, fighting with the flesh and the flesh is fighting with the Spirit. One of the major struggles is listening to worldly music. I've talked to so many people and they say right when they got saved, like, the hardest thing to get rid of was the music. Just like Brother Ellie was talking about the other day, that's why so many of them end up like compromising and going to like this other type of music of Christianity that's not even, it's just like crap music, number one, but it's like just this compromised view. They just feel like they're still just hanging on by a thread to that worldly music. So that's why it would be so much easier if you know, a new Christian that's struggling with getting rid of, you know, this worldly music, if we could come and we could approach them. And we could, you know, they could see the love that we have for the hymns, number one. That right there is impressive to people. But if they see us when we're walking around and we're singing the hymns, we're talking about the hymns, we're showing them a lot of the hymns in the hymnal, I mean, that's going to make a big difference in somebody's life. It's going to make them a lot less likely to keep listening to that music. And that can really hinder your growth, because the music out there is just, half of it is disgusting. A lot of the worldly music today is just wicked and it's horrible, the type of stuff. And it's getting worse and worse and worse. So, I mean, that can really, really hinder a person. Even a Christian that comes to church every week, reads their Bible every day, but they just love the worldly music. They just love it. They just want to keep listening to it. That will hinder their growth majorly, because they're just pumping all that wickedness into their mind. And here's the thing. A lot of people that listen to worldly music, they don't just do it for, you know, just 1 hour a week. They're going to be listening to it for 2-3 hours a day. That's something we need to be teaching to others also. We need to be teaching our children. You know, that's why I love the idea of teaching my daughter how to play the piano so much when she was younger, because I'm just going to make her play hymns her whole life. And then you think all of a sudden when she's 30 years old, she's going to be like, well, I'm going to switch to this other kind of music. No, of course not. She's going to keep playing hymns. What you raise your children up to do, that's what they're going to do later in life. You know, if you raise your children in the right ways, that's what they'll end up doing with the rest of their life. Now, look here at Ephesians chapter number 5. Look at verse number 19. We'll read verse number 18 too. And be not drunk with wine, wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit, speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord. And there's nothing better for me when I'm with another like fellow Christian, especially one that's newly around. I love to hear like people just like in their everyday, if you're just like doing something with them, they invite you to their house or whatever, and they're just walking around just singing the hymns throughout the day. You can see that it's just embedded into their minds when they do that. That all the time is just in their heart constantly all throughout the day. Look over at Colossians chapter number 3. Colossians chapter number 3. Colossians chapter number 3. Look at verse number 16. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. Now, we get a little bit more information in this verse that we don't get in the other. So he says right here in the beginning of the verse, the very first statement, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom. Then he tells you, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Do you know why we sing the hymns? Because it includes a lot of the Word of God. Because the Word of God is in there everywhere. There's tons of doctrine in those hymnals. That's why we sing the hymns. And somebody could say, well, you know, there's this other kind of music that's spiritual songs. Do you know what makes it spiritual? Jesus said, the words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. And people want to refer to like this contemporary Christian music, and they want to say, hey, it's spiritual, it talks about God. Does it have the Word of God in it? Nope. Because if it doesn't, it's not a spiritual song.
Right.
It's very clear in the statement. He says, let the Word of God dwell in you richly in all wisdom. And then he says, teaching and admonishing yourselves. Teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. The reason why we sing the hymns is because it contains the Word of God. And if I'm going to sing some other kind of music, I'm only going to sing it if it has the Word of God in it. That is what a spiritual song is. And there's so many areas. The reason why, and you say, well, this, everything you're preaching this morning seems just so, you know, just so much like common sense. Of course I'm going to teach my children, you know, the Bible. Of course I'm going to teach my children, you know, to do what they should do. Of course I'm going to try to disciple Christians, and I'm going to look for opportunity to disciple other Christians. Well, the last generation didn't do that.
Right.
It obviously isn't so just much common sense as we think.
Right.
Why are all of these kids that grew up in independent fundamental Baptist churches, why are they going to these fun centers? Because their parents failed. Why are all these Christians coming into all these independent fundamental Baptist churches and they're saved and they're there for 2-3 months and then they leave and go to a fun center? You know why? Because somebody didn't go and take them under their wing and show them the importance of the hymns. Show the importance of the Bible. Show them the importance of the doctrines and the Word of God. That's why. The last generation failed. The last generation, and Pastor Anderson's been preaching about this recently, and it couldn't be more true at a time right now when it's just showing itself even more and more. Because things don't get better. You know, it's very rare that, you know, that obviously we have a lot of young people in our church that didn't grow up, you know, in an independent fundamental Baptist movement. But that's not the usual. Normally, an independent fundamental Baptist, you know, their parents were an independent fundamental Baptist, and their parents were, you know, a Christian. Normally, you can trace that genealogy to where they have a family member that taught that to them. That's not the normal. I don't want my kids going to a fun center when they're older. I don't want my kids, you know, just looking at church like it's a joke and like it's a social club. I want them to take it serious. And, you know, here's the thing, too. There's so many great independent fundamental Baptist leaders that were great in a lot of areas, other areas of their life, but they failed when it came to childbearing.
Yep.
There's so many examples of this. You know, obviously Ken Hovind has a ton of problems in his life, but he had a time, you know, when he was, you know, when he was doing great things for God. Just leave it at that. Where he did win many souls to the Lord. He has his own problems and stuff now. But even at that time when he was doing great things for the Lord, he failed when parenting his child. When your child has a testimony and he's like, I was never saved growing up, and then I heard Ray Comfort preach when I was 22. It's like, dude, what are you doing with your parenting? You know, yeah, it's really worth it being gone 364 days a week when your own son says that he never heard the true gospel until he's like 23, and that's even repenting your sins.
Right.
It's not worth it. And then there's so many examples of this. Jack Hiles was a great man of God. But then he's got a son-in-law that steps in that's like some sexual deviant.
Yep.
It's like, dude, you're not paying enough attention, you know, to the next generation. You're not trying to teach others enough. You know, it's important to get up behind the pulpit and preach, to masses. But it's also important, and this is what I'm talking about, it's also important, and probably even more important, to step aside and do personal discipleship, direct discipleship, one-on-one, where you take somebody directly under your wing. Just like Paul did to Timothy, and he said, my son, right?
Yep.
There's a direct relationship. He's just not preaching to many people and then stepping aside and hoping they get it right. He sees somebody that's zealous, that wants to serve God, and he takes time out of his day, and he's proactive about it. And he goes aside and says, hey, Timothy, I'm going to teach you everything that God has taught me. All these revelations that I know, I'm going to teach to you. And I want you to take it and teach it to somebody else who you know is going to teach to the next generation. Who you know is going to keep teaching it to other people. Turn to Titus chapter number 2. Titus chapter number 2. As fathers to our sons, we need to be teaching our sons to be masculine. We need to be taking our children aside, our sons aside, and teaching them to do things with their hands.
Amen.
Teaching them how to work on cars. Teaching them how to do, you know, construction work. Teaching them to be a man, not to be a girl.
Yep.
Women need to be taking their daughters aside. They need to be, you know, mothers need to be taking their daughters aside, and they need to be teaching their ladies how to be a lady. They need to be teaching their daughters how to be feminine. Look at Titus chapter number 2. We'll begin reading verse number 1. But speak thou the things which become sound doctrine. Excuse me. That the aged men be sober, grave, temperate, sound in faith and charity and patience. The aged women likewise, that they be in behavior as becometh holiness, not false accusers, not given to much wine, teachers of good things. Notice that, teachers of good things. And then Paul says this when writing to Timothy, verse number 4, that they may teach the young women to be sober, to love their husbands, to love their children, to be discreet, chaste, keepers at home, good, obedient to their own husbands, that the word of God be not blasphemed. So the women, they need to be teaching. The experienced women, the experienced mothers, the experienced, you know, wives, they need to be teaching the next generation. Not only the next generation, just new Christians. They need to be teaching them what a godly, and be a great example of what a godly, modest, you know, righteous woman, the way that they're supposed to act. And there's a lot of things that have become lost in the last generations. Things that the Bible teaches are good for us, like breastfeeding. There's plenty of examples of people in the Bible breastfeeding. You know, the ladies now, it's like, you know, we ended up having to, our generation, to like reinvent the wheel. Now, all this information we should hold dear to us because it took us so long to find it. Right. We need to make sure that the women pass that down to the next generation, that not only to your children, but also to the other Christian women in the church. The importance of breastfeeding, the importance of home remedies and not just filling your body with junk food, the importance of eating good food and being healthy and things like that. Things that have just been completely lost in the past generations. Especially when it's in a situation like that, when we had to struggle and fight to find the truth, it should be that much more dear to us, and we should understand what it's like when you are blinded and you don't know all these truths and how great it was to find them. So we should be proactive, and the women and the ladies should be proactive to go out and to teach these things to, you know, to the next generation. Obviously, they need to be teaching their children, like I had mentioned already before. And another thing along those lines, you know, there's many things that we should be teaching our children, and another one is soul winning. We should start training up our children as soon as they're capable, as soon as they're able. We should set aside a time, not only just for basic Bible knowledge and teaching them doctrines and commandments that they need to be keeping, but we should set aside a time to where we're teaching our children how to go soul winning. And here's a cool thing about a child going soul winning is, just like if anybody, you know, is a little bit more, sometimes, you know, women are better with giving the gospel to women. And sometimes men, oftentimes, are better to give the gospel to men just because they're more relatable. Well, the same thing I've noticed is true with kids a lot of times. Kids are just easier to get saved in general, but a lot of times if a child approaches another child, it's easier for that kid to get another kid saved just because they're more relatable. They're on the same wavelength. So we should be training our children, you know, to get to be a soul winner immediately. As soon as they're able to learn the Bible, as soon as they're able to have these understandings, they should be learning how to go soul winning. Amen. The women need to be teaching the older women, the experienced women need to be teaching the younger women. And the same goes for all the men in the church. You know, if somebody, like I mentioned earlier, the first point was men in the ministry. A pastor needs to be looking for other pastors to train. A deacon needs to be looking for other people that are interested. Hey, I would like to maybe be a deacon one day and training the next deacon, right? An evangelist needs to be looking for other people that are interested in being an evangelist or a missionary and saying, hey, I'm going to teach you everything that I've learned so far. I'm going to teach you everything that I've learned over the years in training and teaching that person. You know, like I said, fathers need to be, you know, maybe a father that has 7, 8, 9 children, he should be teaching the other fathers that maybe has 1, 2 children. We should be looking for opportunities. We should be being proactive. Turn to Psalms chapter 34. We should be proactive and look for people to take under our wing. We should look for new Christians that come into the church that we could train and that we could teach. You know, while our children are growing up, we should be the one to give them the gospel. You know, I want to be the one to get my children saved. I want to be the one, you know, when they're able to, you know, to get saved, when they're able to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, I want to be the one that's there at that moment when they believe on Jesus. I want to be the one that taught them, hey, you know, Jesus loves you. Jesus wants you to go to heaven. And then be there when they get saved. You know, these are all things that we need to be teaching our children. That our children, that, and we need to be diligent when we do it so that they teach the next generation, right?
Amen.
So we'll end here in Psalms chapter number 34. Psalms chapter number 34. Psalms chapter number 34, look at verse number 11. So it says, come, ye children, hearken unto me. I will teach you the fear of the Lord. And everything that we teach to anyone needs to be from the Bible. We need to be teaching people the fear of the Lord to keep the commandments, right? And he says, come ye children. David says that. He's not necessarily just talking about his kids. He's talking about ye children as in like his sons in the faith. People that he's the teacher to. right? And when you become the teacher, it helps you grow a lot. I know that I've learned so much just from having to sit down and teach my wife things, that I understand things in a better way while trying to teach it. Uh-huh. You know, and so it helps you actually learn and grow while you're teaching other people. So we need to be looking for opportunities to find sons in the faith, to find children that we, not only our own children, you know, of our literal seed, physical seed. We need to be looking for people in the church. We need to be looking for people maybe that we get saved, that we're going to, you know, become one of our proselytes, come, you know, one of our proteges in the faith that we can teach. And we need to be able to say, come ye children, hearken unto me, and I will teach you the fear of the Lord. Everything that we teach to them, you know, needs to be from God's word. Ultimately, that's where it comes from. Just like when God gave the commandments and all the statutes to Moses, and he taught, right? He became the leader, and he taught. Just like, you know, Paul received the revelations directly from Jesus Christ, and then he taught Timothy, and then Timothy kept teaching. Just like when Jesus said to his disciples, you know, all the things that I taught you, you go and teach to all the nations. We need to, and this is my last point, we need to be spending our time first learning the Bible. If you want to be able to teach other people, you better make sure that you know it first. Amen. It needs to be coming from the Lord. Right here he says he's going to teach them the fear of the Lord. You know what you need to first know? You need to know the fear of the Lord. You need to know the commandments. If you're a mother, you need to know how to raise your children, how to rear your children. You need to know all the good tips about homekeeping. You need to know, if you're a father, you know, you better be masculine already. But you need to know how to teach your kids how to be a man, how to work on cars, how to do things that are manly things. A lot of that stuff's lost today. Right. And you know, and a lot of that stuff's lost today. And that's why there's all these weird kids walking around in skinny jeans that look weird. Yep. You think these kids can work on cars? Seriously, you think that's a coincidence? No. Not a chance. I mean, if you went to a college campus and you walked up to one of these typical feminine kids and you said, hey, do you know how to do drywall? What do you think they're going to say? Not a chance. Right. Do you know how to work on a car? Do you know how to change rotors? Do you know how to change brakes? They're going to be like, I have a clue what that is. What's a rotor?
Yeah.
Seriously. Yep. It's not a coincidence. You know what I mean? Yeah. And it's because their fathers didn't teach them.
That's right.
And the same thing goes in the churches too, because all the people are following the same pattern. All the churches, the IFB churches, are following the same pattern as the world.
Right.
So it's not different when it comes when we're talking about the world nowadays. It's sad, but it's not. Yeah. So we need to make sure that our our line biologically of our kids isn't the same. And not only that, but our spiritual line of sons, Timothy, right? Of just all the people that we train isn't the same.
Amen.
And that we're being proactive and we're not withholding all this information. Let's bow our heads and have a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, God, we thank you for this opportunity to come and serve you, dear Lord. We're thankful that somebody was able to take us under their wing, dear Lord, and help us to return the same favor to other people and to teach many others and to entrust it unto people that we believe would teach the next generation as well, the next new Christians as well. We love you and we ask you that you would just be with us and keep us safe and bless the rest of the day and the rest of the services that we'll have. And in Jesus Christ's name, amen.
Amen.